A very good morning to everybody. I hope everybody is doing well. I hope you all are geared up for your new adventure, CET. Great, great. Let a few more add and then we begin. Yes, students, I do understand this anxiety. But then we are here, we help you out as usual. Okay, a few more. Okay, so you all know that the English examination in form of CET is for the very first time that's being taken. Usually when it comes to CET, students are tested in the subjects of mathematics and science, but the introduction of English is possibly because it is at a very, you know, root level, 10th standard, and for your college exams you need CET. So there's nothing too much you got to look into. What has to be done is we are just going to revise all of the previous concepts we have done so far from grade possibly 1 to grade 10. The only thing, the only glitch would be for students who are from ICSE, but again, no problem. When I'm here, I'll take you through the journey. All the SSE students, you already know what has to be done. You have been trained under me. So there's not a problem at all. We are just going to revise. Okay, so let's begin with the revision altogether. So the very first topic today I'm taking is on a very light note, something that you all know. Possibly you do not know the exact keyword. Okay, we begin with collocations. So what is collocations? Let me start. Yeah. Now when talking about collocations, collocations comes from two different words. One is co and the other word is location, right? This word simply tells me the placement of two words that go next to each other. There are certain phrases, certain idioms, certain words which go simply next to each other by default. Natural fit of each other is collocation. In simple words, the juxtaposition of two words going next to each other and making certain sense is collocation. You must have come across a lot many words, lot many phrases, which are a perfect fit for each other. For example, when you go, when you go to a mountain range and you see snow-capped mountains. So this snow-capped mountains becomes your collocation. You would never say snow-capped rivers. You would never say snow-capped lakes. You would always say snow-capped mountains. So such words, when they are used together, it becomes collocation. Similarly, when I say fast food, now this becomes my collocation. But similarly, when I have to, if at all, I want to say, bring me some quick food, would it anyway make sense? No. Why? Because fast food are juxtaposed with each other. They are a natural fit for each other. Such are called as collocations. I hope I'm making sense. This is just the beginning. I'll take you more towards it. Now you can have collocations in lot many forms. Now we have done phrasal verbs. If you remember, ICSE, your entire year went into learning phrasal verbs. Yeah. So phrasal verbs are also more like collocations. Now, why collocations? Look into a natural fit, which would mean investigate. Look for a natural fit for each other, which would mean search. Similarly, if I have to tell you one adjective with a noun. One adjective with a noun. Now here, let's think of some collocations. For example, I say strong tea. All of those students who are still sleepy, this is for you. Strong tea is needed to wake you up, to have a good kick start of the day. So adjective plus noun, this made a collocation. Let's talk about something else. For example, if I have to say one adverb and the other is adjective. When I say fundamentally wrong, fundamentally wrong meaning is there are certain decisions taken by Supreme Courts and High Courts which you feel are fundamentally incorrect, fundamentally wrong. This is something you do not agree with. Again, go back to your argumentative essays. All my ICSE students, you used to write the last very line, I strongly disagree. SSE students, if you remember, when we were writing view counter view, I strongly agree with the statement. I strongly disagree with the statement. Again, such things. Now that would be adverb plus verb. When you say strongly agree, strongly disagree, these are all your collocations. I'll give you more collocations. For example, if I say you are describing certain person, all your descriptive essays, collocations play very important role, specifically when we are talking about writing your essays, writing your creative writing, how you describe. Now, if I want to describe someone and I say this so and so person is a strong man. Okay, strong man is fine. But if I say heavy man, now this is incorrect. So they are not supposed to be next to each other. They are not a correct fit for each other. This is called as collocations. I hope the topic is understood. The concept is understood. If yes, please let me know. Super. Now, how would you be tested on this? Very important. That's the question in your head. So your questions would be very simple. For example, if I tell you a question would be given to you. Let me give you a question. Just hold on. Yeah. My question goes this way. Dash. Period. And now I'll give you few options. You tell me which goes correct. Okay. Through your comments, tell me which option is a correct option. Wait for the options. Now tell me. Okay. A lot of students are saying long period. Long, I would not use with period. No. Yes, I can have indefinite period. Yes, allowed. And I can have prolonged period. When you have something existing with you from quite a long time, it is prolonged period. Another way you can be tested is a sentence would be given to you. one. Let's see this one. Okay, tell me. Okay, let me see who gave the first answer. Okay. Good one, Jitesh. Jitesh gave a good answer. Shitesh, good one. Bitter. Jui, good one. Urja, very good. Samiksha, good. Okay, we never use wicked, we never use evil with experience. Wicked people, evil people. Very bad is not a correct English, specifically when we are collocating. So we would not use. Very good, Mohit. So you would always say bitter experience. I hope you. I am making sense. Certain words that go together and make sense naturally. This is your collocation. I would give you some more examples for you to understand this topic better. Another way your teachers can ask you this particular question could be in CET. A lot of times you are asked to write in a way wherein a sentence is given and you are now supposed to add a verb of your own choice. A lot many students say, please stay with my promise. Please fulfill my promise. Now, this is incorrect. You always would say, please keep my promise. Keep my promise, keep your promise would always mean, make sure that whatever promise you have made is making sense. You do fulfill whatever is needed. This is keep promise. Again, this is one way of collocating words. So this particular topic includes, again, a brief revision. It can include two different things. Number one, you have noun placed with another noun. You can have adjective placed with adverb. You have adverb placed with verb. And you have to collocate. Now, for your CET exam, of course, it would not be that very difficult for you to understand how to collocate. You look at the options, you understand which is the best fit, and you put it. Now, very important, you are not writing anything. You have to color the OMR sheets. Okay, so make sure you look at the options correctly first very time. The very first option that I gave you for dash period, a lot of you felt long can be the answer, prolonged can be the answer, and you got confused. So the very first thing you did was you sorted A. And then you realized, no, this does not sound that well. Let me go back and let me color the D1. Do not do that. Take sufficient time. Take 2 seconds to understand what the question is trying to tell you and then color it. So this was collocations. All right, I'll also help you with one more thing. Let's see. Okay, let's try this one. Let's try this practice set. Each one of you, one at a time. Okay, let's take the first one. Only 33% of the students who dashed the CET exam passed it. Of course, the best fit here would be C. Yes, who took the CET exam? You take an exam. All right, and then you pass it. You never write the exam and pass it. So for all those of you who have given me wrote as the answer, that is incorrect. Your correct answer obviously is 2. So for all those who gave the correct answer, a pat on your back, very good. It took us all day to clean up the office after the burglary. The thieves dash a terrible mess. They, very good. Almost everybody gave the correct answer. They made a terrible mess. Very good. The chances of England winning the next World Cup are dash. Now here I want you all to pay attention. take a deep breath and do it. Tell me which is the best fit here. Best fit. And give your answer. Okay, a lot of you, I guess, are watching cricket. It is highly unlikely. You don't say massively unlikely. No, you don't say grossly unlikely. No, you don't say greatly unlikely. You say highly unlikely. High probability, high chances, similarly, highly unlikely. Two adverbs placed next to each other giving a perfect fit. With unlikely, you would always say highly unlikely. Okay, let's move on to this fourth one. I wasn't dressed for the occasion. I felt dash out of place. Now, this is very simple. You have heard this n number of times. Totally out of place. Amazing. Amazing, amazing. Very good. Totally is the answer. Very good. Let's move on to the fifth one. He speaks with a dash Liverpool accent. Some of my American colleagues have trouble understanding what he is talking about. Now here, I really want to know what you all say. Tough Liverpool accent, okay, this is what you want to say. So if you say tough is incorrect, tough man, that's the correct collocation. You would say broad. Broad Liverpool accent. With accent, you always use broad. Broad meaning words, you know, which are on someone's tongue in such a way that they cannot change it. We Indians also have certain accent and we want to have it the way it is. You have been pronouncing poem throughout your life. We had this poem in the classroom. But basically, it is poem. Now, we are so very used to with this word poem. We also use strong. Yeah, strong accent is also fine, but here we do not have the option strong. We have broad, so broad is the correct word. This was Urja's question. Yes, I hope it's answered. Strong is also used with accent. Yes. Moving further. Yes, this all would be sent on the group. I made a mistake. One sec. Sixth one, now this is important again. Reports are that Bill Gates earned more than $500 million annually are dash exaggerated. Now Bill Gates earning has to be more. He has given so a lot of alimony as well to his wife. He has to earn more. Yeah, jokes apart. It is not extremely, but it is grossly. Grossly. Altogether, in totality, whenever you talk about income, whenever you talk about expenditure, whenever you talk wherein money is involved, you say grossly. Grossly meaning in totality. So I hope this is understood. That's the answer. Okay, now here, pay attention to the seventh one. Okay, I made one silly error, students. Earns. Yeah, sorry. Okay. We are low on petrol, but the next station is very dash. So we should be fine. Tell me. Okay, students say none of these. Okay. There are students who are saying close. There are students who are saying near. Okay. As per both the English American and British English, both the words near and close are fine when we are talking about distance, when we are talking about traveling. So you always say the shop is near to my house, is close to my house. So similarly, we are low on petrol, but the next station is very close or near. Both the options are fine. Here, the answer was both the options. My students, even in your CET examination, there are chances wherein near is fine. Okay, we have Suvarna here, and the child says near does not fit. The shop is near my house. Perfectly fine. Perfect English, no problem with it. It's very near to my place. This is how you say. The bus stop is quite near to my place. Perfect English. So near and close, both are fine. Very near, fine, better. Very near, fine. Okay. And if you had the word nearby, that would be great. That would be great. Okay. 8-1, I don't know him that well. He is only a dash acquaintance. You cannot say loose acquaintance. You cannot say weak as well here. You say casual. Again, this X tells me nothing is required. Casual acquaintance. I mean, just hi, bye. I don't talk to the person much. Maybe he is just someone who has come to the place. Okay. Yeah. Next one, I am an honest and dash citizen. You don't say lawful in correct. You don't say law citizen. You don't say law watching citizen. But you say law abiding citizen. Yes, perfect. Perfect. For all those who gave the correct answer, very good. Amazing. Last one, we didn't arrange to meet. Meaning here, there was no plan for us to meet. It was dash coincidence that we met. It was pure coincidence. Now, again, here you could have the word sheer. It was sheer coincidence. Sheer meaning it was mere coincidence. Even that could be a perfect match. Okay, Shitish, tell me what's the problem. You can type. You feel pure is not the answer. So you feel clear is the answer, clean is the answer, and great is the answer. Even pure coincidence, no problem at all. Pure coincidence. Okay, sheer and clear would not come together. Sheer would mean only. It was only a coincidence. Sheer and mere are synonyms to each other in terms of adverb. Just one second. It was a. Okay, a small silly error. Yeah, it was a. It would, okay, Prince, it would not be great. Great coincidence, incorrect. Great pleasure. It was a great pleasure meeting him. Dakshal Pawar, why is A not? Question number 8. Okay, I don't know him that well. He is only an acquaintance if you wish to use this X. If I want to use this X, I would have used an acquaintance. But here I have a dash acquaintance. This simply tells me I need to have an adjective here. And the correct adjective I can use here is casual. I hope you got your answer, Dakshal. Okay, super. So I hope collocations, this particular part is clear for everybody once and for all. Easiest topic. And you would not even lose marks. Let me just quickly check if I missed out anything. Okay, I have one question with clear. What can be the collocation? Okay, you all know clear water, clear river, but you can also have clear misunderstanding, which is, you know, just like oxymoron. Clear misunderstanding. It is quite evident. Clearly misunderstood me. He clearly misunderstood me. You get it? So clear and misunderstanding could be a collocation. So with collocation, this is done. This was my topic number 1 for today. Let's move on to topic number 2, which is again a very, very, very easy topic. And then we move on to something which needs to be done from the base. So second topic is compound words. Again, you all love this thing. When you were kids in your kindergarten, you were taught compound words. Two words coming together, okay, and forming a new word is called as compound words. crystal clear is a collocation. Yeah, it is also, it is not a metaphor. It is not a metaphor here at least. Again, how it is used, Jitesh, would depend whether it is a metaphor or a collocation. But it is ideally a collocation. Okay. Compound words, again, I'm taking you back to your kindergarten days where, you know, the teacher said foot plus ball equals to football. Black plus board is equal to blackboard. Okay, now this topic seems so very easy. Yes, it can be a part. Oxymoron, Vedant is a part of your figures of speech. And I would be doing it eventually in the upcoming classes, so you have it for your examination. Compound words now, let me take you a bit in detail about compound words. Compound words are of three types. Don't be shocked, it's okay. For all the students who are hearing this for the very first time, compound words. Two words coming together and giving out a complete new word is called as compound words. But there are three types of compound words. One is open compound words or open compounds. Then you have closed compounds. And you have hyphenated compounds. Okay. Let's see certain examples so that you can understand better. Now, when I say open compounds, words like ice cream, they are open compounds. You don't usually put a hyphen with ice cream. Ice cream can be written this way as well. Ice cream. This is your open compound. Okay. Next, you have closed compounds. Closed compounds, when two words come together, football, as I say, you know, this becomes your closed compounds. And then you have hyphenated compounds. Very simple here. Words like mother-in-law. This is your hyphenated compound. Such an easy topic. Now, how would you be tested on this? Okay. How would you be tested? Again, similarly, the way I gave you for your earlier one, collocations, I give you one word. Okay, let's play this. I give you one word and you tell me what would the next word be to make it a compound word, not a collocation, student. To make it a compound word. All set? Everybody? All set? Let's do this. Let's see who gives the first answer. Okay? Yes. First one. My first one, first word is white. Come on. With white, give me a compound word. Whiteboard, okay, very good. Whiteboard, fine. Come on, think of something. Something better. Whiteboard is given. White chalk, no. White color, no. White cream, no. White head. These are all collocations. White tiger, white pen, all collocations. Collocations, they are. Okay, whitewash. Yes, whitewash is fine. Whitewash. Whiteboard. A background is one word altogether. It's one altogether a different word. Whitener is not allowed. Okay. White out. Blackout sooner. What is white out? White elephant, white horse. Would all be into collocation, students? This is not compound words. Okay, wait, hold on. Do not give so many chats. Collocations, compound words. Collocations, two words which are best fit for each other. Compound words, two different words coming together and giving out a new meaning altogether. Now you all are fine, yeah. Do not be confused. White Smith. I guess that's the name of something, right? By the way. Okay. Fine. ED is fine. White wash. Okay. Fine. Let me give you another word. whitenings that would soham become basically prefix and suffix example. Vaidehi, whitesmith is a person who makes stuff from metal. Stuff from metal, okay? It's one word, fine, you can have it. Yes. Kabir, you can directly jot things in the comment section. Kabir, there's some problem from my end. I cannot unmute you better. Okay, let me give you another word for compound word. Let's say so many questions. Yeah. Yes, white lies will be a collocation jewel. Yes. Sharvari, we are not using prefix. With white, I need to have suffix to make it a compound word. Unless you are asked that way, dash white. Okay. Correct. So still questions coming in, still questions pouring in. No, they are two different things. Collocations and compound words are two different things. They are not the same. Definitely not the same. One more. Give me here. Come on. Thunderstorm, very good. Thunderbolt, very good. Yeah, storms. Thundershock, okay, fine. Thunder song, okay. Thunderstruck, fine, very good. Super, thunder cloud, okay. I still given thunder cloud. It would be one word, yes. Thunderbolt is one word, yes. Okay, I hope I took everybody's answer. So these are kind of compound words. No, you would not have questions where you are asked identify whether the word is a compound word or a collocation. Such kind of questions would not appear, definitely. Do not worry about that. Now, the next very thing, very good, Prince, amazing. I guess I have taken everybody's answer. Yeah. Majority of you said thunderstorm, cloud, thunderstrike. Okay, fine, super. Let's move on to, yes, Mohit, correct. Let's move on to the next amazing topic. Now, this topic requires ICSE to pay careful attention because we have never done this before. Or even if we have done this, it was never in detail. SEC, you already know this, so it is a brief revision for you all. Okay, when I talk about verbs, when I talk about action words, okay, you have learned different forms of verbs in your entire career as a student. So far, and we all know there are too many kinds of verbs. But today, I'm taking you to two major kinds of verbs. Number one, finite verbs. Number two, non-finite verbs. Now, what's the basic difference between finite verb and non-finite verb? So understand, finite verbs are those verbs wherein you understand the tense of the sentence. They would be your actual, main action word in the sentence. She decided to hand over the papers to so and so. No, I ain't writing anything. Okay, you got confused, please. I'm not writing.
Just listen to what I'm saying, rather. May I?
Okay, yeah. So, finite verbs are those verbs which would be the main action word in the sentence. I decided to hand over the papers to someone. My main action word is my decision. I decided. Decided becomes the main action word. So this is my finite verb. Finite verb will always help you to understand the tense of the sentence. Hold on. Yeah. So finite verbs, they will always be the main action word. Just let me know. He would help you identify the tense. I felt so that I'm not audible. Okay. Am I now audible? I did feel I'm not audible. Okay. Fine. Helps in identification of tense. And always remember, finite verbs are those verbs that will always be affected or influenced. You are not supposed to write. I will be sending everything to you in the PDF file as usual, as I always do. So affected or influenced by person, by number. I'll give you a simple example here. When I say she decides to go to the party after school. She decides. My tense here, simple present tense. Since I have singular pronoun or singular subject, my verb is also singular. Similarly, if I change the number of my subject, I say they. Now they here would be decide. They decide to go to the party after school. This is your finite verb. So what is your non-finite verb? Contrary to finite verb, non-finite verbs are those verbs which are not the main word or main action word in the sentence. Number one. Number two, they act either as adjective, they act either as noun, they act either as verb, they act either as adverb in the sentence. So they basically act. They act as noun, verb, adjective. Okay, adverb, adjective, not the main verb. Also, very important when I talk about non-finite verb, they would never get influenced, changed by the number, or they would never be influenced. By number or person. I'll give you a simple example. I'm taking the example, above example, she decides or decided to go for the party after school. Now, decided is my main action word. But after decided, I have another verb. I decided to do something. So to do becomes, to go becomes my non-finite verb. And when I place to with an action word, it is called as infinitives. For all the students, we have done the base of infinitives. Infinitives are to plus action word. So this is your first non-finite verb. Question can be in the form of identify the type of non-finite verb, underlined non-finite verb from the example or from the question, and you would be given a series. A, infinitives, B, gerund, C, participle, and D, something else. You have to understand which is a infinitive or which one is a gerund or which one is a participle. So far, infinitives part was fine. But now comes the complicated part where we are talking about participles and gerunds. Whatever you are doing for time being, just pay entire attention to whatever I'm saying. SSC students often goof up with participles and gerunds. Now, what's the basic difference between participle and gerund? Participles you all have learned in your early classes, where participles are of two types: present participle and past participle. Present participle usually ing, correct? And your past participles usually end with ed, en, n. They are usually the third form of verbs. They are usually the third form of words. For example, I say a break. Break my base form of broke would go into my past tense. But if I'm talking about participle, something that happened long back, I would say broken. So broken becomes my past participle. Okay. Similarly, drink, drank, drunk. Correct? Hang, hanged, hung. Correct? Perfect, students. So these are my participles. They are third form of verbs. Then what is so difficult? It is so easy to sound. 1 second. Am I audible now? Okay, fine. Audible now. Okay. Do you want me to repeat anything? I just said participles. I gave certain examples regarding past participles. I said break is my base form of word, broke is my past tense, and broken is my perfect tense. Seems to be Suvarna, that's wrong all of a sudden. Okay. Proceeding further. Participles, we have present participles and we have gerunds. They both look so same because both of them end with ing. Break, breaking. See, seeing. Hang, hanging. Jump, jumping. But have will give you understanding of whether it is a participle or it is a gerund. Oh, my voice is still lagging. Okay, do one thing. Once you get the audit of whatever teaching, you will be able to understand better. Possibly then the voice would not be lagging. But if any doubts, you can definitely ask me. No problem. I'll repeat once again if it is clearly not understood. Okay. अच्छा यू वॉन्ट मी टू कीप माई वीडियो ऑफ, ऑल राइट फाइन इफ यू से सो. लेट्स सी हियर जेरेंस एंड पार्टिसिपेंट्स. नाउ जेरेंस ऑलवेज एक्ट एज अ नाउन. One way to identify whether your ing verb is a gerund or a participle. So gerunds always act as a noun, which means they can either be the subject of the sentence or object of the sentence. Okay, I'll give example. First example, I like to walk. When I say I like to walk here becomes my infinitive, correct? Now I say I like walking. Walking here becomes my gerund. Why? Because it is used as the object of the sentence. This is object of the sentence, object. And so this becomes gerund. Clear? Sure? Another example I can give you where it is used as the subject of the sentence. Walking is a great exercise. Now here, walking becomes the subject of the sentence. So walking is my gerund. For anybody who isn't understanding, you can tell me and I'll repeat again. This is an important part. Finite, non-finite verbs, important part. Any student who wants me to repeat? Nobody? Okay, I would repeat once again, no problem. Gerunds are all those ing words wherein the difference is, I will. The difference is always, it always acts as a noun. And when I say it always acts as a noun, they are either the subject or the object of the sentence. This is how you will understand it is a gerund. Let me also take you to one or two examples of participles and then help you with what I am saying. Participles are those words which are scattered somewhere in the sentence. Okay, present participle specifically. Somewhere scattered in the sentence and they are acting either as a supporting verb. They are supporting verb. They can be adjectives. All your adjectives that end with ing are participles. Adjective. They can also be adverb, acting as an adverb in the sentence. For example, I give you one example. Let's see. I walked into the forest. Penetrating its deep silence. Now, my main action word in this particular sentence is walked. And this is my finite verb. Correct? Then I saw the word penetrating, which ends with ing. Now, I tried understanding and analyzing, is penetrating here my subject or the object of the sentence. So how would I know? I went back. I say, I is my subject. Walked is my verb. Forest is my object. Okay. What did I now get? It is neither the subject nor the object. So it is not a gerund. Also, this ends with ing and is one of the verb penetrating. You are actually penetrating an action of penetrating. So this becomes my present participle. Clear? Clear? Anybody? Yes, Prince, walked is past participle verb of walk. Yes, walked. Even in your participle, it remains walked. Yes, I will explain once again from the roots. Gerund silences noun. Kshitij, silences noun. And we are not supposed to do anything with noun. Yes, I will give a few more examples on this. Urja, yes, beta, I will. Okay, let me just take you back again. Gerunds, they act as a noun. They are either the subject of the sentence or object of the sentence. On contrary, past participles are supporting verb. They can be adjective. They can be adverb. If you see here, they are supporting verb. For this particular question, when I see walked is my one verb, and then I say penetrating, the second word. How did I walk? I walked penetrating its deep silence. I'll give you a few more examples that will help you clear your basic understanding of the topic. Let me just give you a few more. Now you pick out which non-finite verb is talked here about, okay? Okay. The endangered species need to be protected by the poachers. Tell me, which word here is the non-finite word? Non-finite word. Okay. Which one is the non-finite word? A lot many of you are saying to be protected. If you say to be protected all together, tell me then which form of non-finite verb is this? To be protected. Like Tanishka has told me to be protected. What type of it is? Whether it is infinitive, gerund or participle? To be is right. Okay, to be I can say this is my infinitive. But to be protected should not come together. It should not be together. Tanishka, to be perfect, beta. To plus action word. This is my infinitive. I got your point. I have one more thing, students. Species. I'm talking about species. Which species? Endangered species. Even this is my past participle. Yes. Protected. Now. Even this is my past participle because need is my action word. My main action word is need. This is my finite word. This is infinitive. This is my past participle. Oops, participle. And even this is my past participle. I hope with this example, things are getting better for you to understand. I'll give you one more example to make it easier and use it for you. Let's say Okay. Australians are bad losers and do not possess the sporting spirit. Now tell me, come on. I gave you the easy sentence. Sporting, okay, identification is done, right? Sporting. Very good, Gargi. Amazing. Very good, Shubhra. Come on, students, give your answer. I would not give the answer so easily. Vaishnavi, very good. Jitesh, very good. Urja, very good. Amazing. Well done. Okay. I'll repeat myself. Whenever I have an adjective, ing working as an adjective, then it will always be a present participle. Here it is working as an adjective. Here it is used as an adjective. So it is a present participle. I would write sporting present participle. It is not a gerund. It is not a gerund. I hope it is understood. I hope this topic is making sense. Okay, still want questions on this, or do you want me to begin with something anew now? Okay, I'll just take a minute's break and I'll just go through all of the chats which I missed out. Okay, you want more questions? Urja, what I would do is I would give you a lot of practice sheets so that you all can solve whenever you all can, and if you have any doubts, then you can come back to me. Okay. But yes, I can still take up a few more questions. I still have time. I will. Chalo. I burst out laughing. Laughing is gerund. Very good. Laughing is gerund. Yes, it is gerund. Yes, it is gerund. Very good. A big round of applause for everybody who was able to crack this. Laughing is a gerund simply because here it is acting as a noun. Laughing is acting as a noun. It is acting as a noun. So it becomes gerund. Very good, Kanaka. Amazing. Kaustubh, Prajakta. Jitesh. Okay, the first answer was given by Shubhra and Shriya. Amazing. Very good. A pat on your back. I'll give you one more. Okay. Urja, how did we get this? I'll tell you, I is my subject. Burst out is my word. What did I burst out in? I burst out in laughing. What? whenever you ask a question, what it either gives you the answer as the subject of the sentence or object of the sentence, right? So here it is giving me as object of the sentence, so it became my gerund. Urja, I hope it is clear for you. Amazing. Let's just one more and then I begin with something new. Okay, this is a good one. Jacks use high speed sewing machines to cut wood. Come on, go for it. Let's see who gives the answer first. Come on. Give me the type as well. Don't just type. Give me the type of the sentence as well. Type of the word as well. Great. First answer comes from Gargi. Gargi, the type of the sentence is incorrect. Very good, Shubhra and Shreya. They gave both the answers. Amazing. Sawing is my gerund. To cut is my infinitive. Round of applause for Shubhra and Shreya. Sorry. Very good, Prince. Ruchira, amazing. Vedant, pretty good. Jitesh, very good. But you have only answered first half of the sentence. Neha, it is not a present participle. It is a gerund. It is acting as a noun. Sawing machine. Okay, it is acting as a noun. High speed what? High speed sewing machine. Correct. Very good, Sharvari. So I hope this part is clear. Okay. Amazing. Now, today's class, I would be wrapping up with something different. We would talk about comprehension passages. Now, if you see the CET rules, you have grammar as well as non-textual passages. These passages would not be of more than 6 to 8 lines. So even I have got a couple of passages for you. And specifically ICSC, this is something different than what you have done so far with your comprehension passages. Usually, SSC comprehension passages have certain grammar questions related to the passage, or maybe they would give a couple of question answers related to the passage. Okay, and they would be very simple, not that very complicated. But you have to know all the grammar concepts if you want to attempt comprehension. They might ask you direct, indirect speech, active, passive voice, identification of gerund, participle, infinitive, simple, compound, complex, anything on anything and everything from the grammar list with regards to the comprehension passage. So let me share with you one comprehension passage that I have with me, specifically designed for today's class. Okay, I am not visible because my video was off. Quickly read this passage. Read this passage and then we move on to finding the answers of the Yes, you have it for your examination. You have it. ready students, shall we? Okay. From the passage, find the meaning of the word a very strong wind. Okay, students are reading. Okay. Correct. Now, this was easy. For all those who gave the answer so easily, also tell me the meaning of the word battered. Come on. Give me the meaning of the word battered without looking at the Google. Very good, Raj. Amazing. Shitij, battered, resulting into massive destruction. Okay. Super. Let's move on to the second one. Second question. Very good, Vedika. Moving on to the second question. Change the voice. Now, this is how the question would appear in your CET paper. A lot many options would be listed. You have to be sure. Keep your eyes open on the correct answer. How would you get your correct answer? These largely treeless isles are frequently battered by Atlantic storms, gales, and rain. I see the word by here, by Atlantic storms. So obviously my answer should begin with Atlantic storms, correct? Now I have two options which begin with Atlantic storms. I have number one A and I have B, B for dog. Let's see which goes correct. Now, when I checked the part A of the sentence, again I have used the word by. So this particular sentence is incorrect. This option is incorrect. Part D, Atlantic storms, gales and rain frequently batter these largely treeless isles. This becomes my perfect answer. So for everybody who gave part D as the answer, amazing, super. I had Urja who had given this answer without even looking at the options. Amazing work, Urja. Too good. Let's move on to the last question. Now, this is tricky. This revealed a number of stone dwellings. What does this refer to? Come on, what does this refer to? You want the passage once again? Okay, students are asking for the passage once again. Read the passage. Yeah, read the passage. No problem. I give you a minute. I give you one more minute, read it thoroughly, and then we go down to the question once again. Yes. Shall I disclose the options? There you go. Okay. Okay, so the correct answer is C. The wind and tide swept away the grass from top of a hill called Scarabra. First correct answer was given by Shitij Mirikar. Very good, Shitij. Yes, Durvesh. You can type your question. First answer was given by him. Yes, a lot many gave C as the answer. Very good. Very good. I am missing out on certain chats. Yes, students, I am teaching and doing so. Have some patience. Correct. Your answer was correct. Perfect. So I hope this is fine. Yes, I am giving you one more comprehension. I hope you are liking it. I'll give you one more. Okay. Yeah. One more comprehension. Okay, there we go. One more. Okay. A small passage. Just read the passage and then we'll look at the questions and their answers. Read students. Why do you want to jump into answering? Read. Understand the passage. Shall we? Okay, Vaidehi, there can only be one answer, beta. Only one. Yeah, okay, I got the answer. All right, I'm waiting. Fine. Okay, the passage focuses on the creative ability of humans being undermined. Dhruv Daga gave the first correct answer. Well done, Dhruv. So, why the creative ability of humans being undermined? Because we often feel that this ability is so rare. We are not making the optimum utilization of this ability that has been conferred upon us naturally. So this is the correct answer. Now, for a lot many who gave A, it was such a close option because you saw the word prison here. And your mind tricked you, this could be the answer, but no, not always it is so. So whenever you are attempting any kind of such comprehensions, remember the key rules. Okay, moving on to the second one. This is what we did right away today. Yes, the concept of limitation and prison has been repeated several times, and both of them simply tell me that my creative ability is undermined. Humans have often undermined it. And so the entire focus is on undermining the ability of creative heart. Okay, Urja? Yeah. Identify the type of non-finite verb of the underlined word school, later university, and then work. Teach us to regulate our lives, imposing a continuous process of restrictions. Come on. I haven't asked to regulate. Yes, that's the catch. To regulate is easy. Tell me what is imposing. Okay. Very good. Majority have given the correct answer. It is present participle. Very good. This is not a noun. Imposing is not a noun. Okay, third one. To regulate infinitive area. 2 plus infinitive. Correct? Amazing. Identify the compound word used in the sentence. keeping ability creative groundwork. Groundwork is the correct answer. I'll again go back to the passage for the last and final one. Give synonym of the word rapidly. Okay, this is your passage. Quickly find out. Superb, superb. Everybody has given the correct answer exponentially. Great, great, great. Amazing. Well done, each of you. So today's class, what I understand is everybody understood all of the topics we did. I will quickly take back you to everything we have done today in a nutshell. Let's quickly go back. Let us revise and then we end the class. Or if you have any doubts, you can ask me. So if you have any doubts, first, let's begin with your doubts. Everybody, you can begin with your doubts. Yeah. The chat is random. Give me the doubts once again. Prince, I didn't get you. Yes, I would. I would. Okay, for SSC, textual grammar for CET can be practiced, no problem. It will just help you to get a clear understanding of the concept. So yes, you can. In the second last question, I'm confused why we chose present participle over present continuous. One second, Abita. Let me just go back to the question. Why did we choose present participle over? Achha, okay. Urja, I got your question. Present continuous tense, correct, Urja? Whenever I have present continuous tense, it would be this way. Are giving. Are working. I need to have one auxiliary, and with that auxiliary, I need to have ing. That will determine present continuous tense. Clear, Urja? Here, I do not have any auxiliary. And since I do not have any auxiliary, it is present participle. Urja, do you want me to repeat? Okay, perfect. Okay. Yes, Kushi, I will. Give me a moment. Sure, I will, Arya. Okay. So, amazing. Only I'll just repeat, I guess students' majority still have doubts with gerund and participle. I'll once again quickly revise with you all, no problem. Wait, I'll revise with new set of examples. Okay, yeah, new set of examples. Gerund and participle. Okay, let's go from the root. I met this charming girl on my trip to Europe. Okay, here my main action word is met. okay, I have nothing to do with NEC because it is my finite work. Now my focus goes on charming, which is an ing word. This ing word is placed before girl, which is basically the object of the sentence. But the girl is the object of the sentence, right? Charming here would be, here it is playing the role of an adjective. So it is present participle. Very good, Urja. Very good. Very good, Arya. So here it is present participle. Amazing. Amazing. Now I twist the question. Dancing girl was excavated at Mohenjo-daro. Now tell me. Very good. This is the subject of the sentence. So this becomes gerund. Very good. Yes, and you can write excavated is your past participle. Very good. Very good for all those who are giving this. Super. Khushi Farote, I hope you are understanding, beta. I hope your doubt is solved. Superb. Understood? Okay. I'll just take a screenshot of this. Yes, Kaustub. They are basically the subject and object. Yes, you can. Who is this? Shalini, you can refer the Blue Book of Grammar. Renan Martin is fine for understanding the concepts. But yes, I would be sending practice sheets in the group today. So you all can practice. And if at all you are not able to understand something, my class is scheduled possibly next Friday, next Wednesday. So I'll be taking up those doubts first and then we begin with something else. Okay. So for the last 6 minutes, a brief recap of what I have done today. I started with collocations and I told you collocations are nothing but words co-located with each other, or rather juxtaposed with one another in a way that they give a correct meaning. They are the best fit for each other. They are collocations. Win someone's heart. This is a collocation. You would win someone's heart. Similarly, cry over something. Again, this is a collocation. They are best fit of one another, with one another. Then we went on to compound words and I taught you there are three types of compound words. First is open compounds, closed compounds and hyphenated compounds. And I told you with so many things around you, you can make compound words. For example, if I say book, so you can have bookworm. This becomes a adjective where you are basically describing someone. He is a bookworm or she is a bookworm. Bookstore, this is also a compound word. Okay, bookmark can also be a compound word. They are not collocations. Yes, they come together, book plus store coming together, and the new word is formed called as bookstore. Then I took you to another journey of finite verbs and non-finite verbs, where I told you finite verbs are all 12 tenses, simple tenses, perfect tenses, continuous tenses, and perfect continuous tenses. It is a combination of all the 12 tenses, finite verbs. And then in detail, we saw not what are non-finite verbs. They are infinitives, gerunds, participle. And in detail, we had an explanation of the same. Last but not the least, we completed comprehensions and how questions can be asked in the form of comprehension passages. So this is what we did for today's first lecture. I hope to meet you all soon with the same enthusiasm, and I wrap my class. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, everybody. Bye-bye. Take care. Everything will be uploaded on the group in some time. Yeah. Bye-bye.